Hello, everybody. Thanks to be here. My presentation is Hispanic in English, and I will be my best to speak in English. I'm Guillaume Lacquière. I'm working at Veolia. I'm a lead developer and Scrum Master. And today I will talk about which serverless platform to use on GCP for serving a TensorFlow model. It's a quite long title, and I would like to highlight some keywords in it. Serverless, serving, and TensorFlow. Before going deeper, I would like to describe each of these keywords. And first is, what's serving in AI pipeline? In AI pipeline, you perform the data acquisition of your data, and then you have to prepare them for exploring and understanding your data. After these steps, you have to build your model, because you understand your data and you can build your model, and then you can train it and then serve it. My talk is only focused on the last steps, only on the serving parts, and all the rest of the pipeline is out of scope. Another word, it's TensorFlow. TensorFlow because it's we are in an open source conference, and I have to talk about a TensorFlow open source product. TensorFlow has been made by Google initially, and Google continue to use it internally and continue to maintain it with the community. The TensorFlow 2 has been released in September this year. TensorFlow is very used by the community because it can be used on the server side. It can be also used on a web browser, thanks to TensorFlow.js, and also on mobile devices, thanks to TensorFlow Lite. Just a last word on TensorFlow. Why this word, TensorFlow? Tensor, it's a mathematical representation of your inputs. Tensor of size 0 is it's a scalar. Size 1 is a vector, an array of number. Size 2 is a matrix, etc., etc. And a flow, because you process this tensor through a graph of several steps for transforming these inputs, and that's perform a processing flow. That's why it's TensorFlow. Last word, it's serverless. Serverless, it's a trendy word in cloud computing, and we can see serverless in two different models. First one is operation model. That means you don't have to care about the server provisioning, the updates, the patching, the high availability, the redundancy, and so on. All the security stuff, like the networking and the patching, are handled by the cloud provider. And finally, you only have to pay as you use. That means you have no traffic, no request, you pay nothing, and if you have a lot of traffic, you pay according with this traffic. And another point of view of serverless is the programmer, the developer point of view, because the developer want to develop services, microservices, that process events, and they don't care if the services are hosted on AWS, GCP, on Azure, or on-premise. They want to develop for bringing value to the customer, and they want to develop something portable and don't care about the server and the underlying platform. So now, for going deeper in this talk, what mean AI platform on GCP? For this, take back the pipeline, the AI pipeline, and we can map several Google Cloud products in front of each steps. It's not the purpose to detail all the components here, but at the end of the pipeline, when we build, train, and serve the model, a component appear each time. It's AI platform. It's a toolbox in on GCP for building, training, and serving the model. And I will talk only on the serving part, and I will talk only on AI platform here. For serving a model, there is two types of process. You are online prediction and batch prediction. Online prediction is when your user is on your website, the user submits a query to your server, and in real time, the user wants to have the answer of the model. In opposition, the batch prediction is you have a lot of data, for example, a file with millions of rows, and you want to perform a batch job to get the results of each row in the file. So let's go with online prediction here. And on GCP, you have one VM, a tiny VM, generally available on GCP, with only one CPU and 2 GB of memory. This VM is tiny and it's cheap. Not cheap because the VM is tiny, but cheap because the platform scale to zero. I mean, if there's no traffic the night or the weekend, you pay nothing. And when you have one request, the platform scale from zero to one instance, and you pay only for the processing plus 10 minutes. When one instance is created, you pay for 10 minutes. It's not perfect as serverless and pay as you use, but after 10 minutes, the instance goes to zero and you pay nothing. Another aspect on this platform, you can deploy TensorFlow models, but also Scikit-learn and XGBoost model if you want. Today, this is generally available, but not perfect because there is no GPU capabilities and you are limited to one CPU. That's why in October this year, Google has released new machine type in beta with more CPUs and more GPUs. Machines are bigger and more expensive. Not more expensive because they are bigger, but because the platform don't scale to zero. I mean, if you have no traffic the night or the weekend, the platform scales to one instance and you will pay at least one VM up, even if you have no traffic. For me, it's not the strict definition of serverless, but this platform have CPUs and GPUs capability, and it's great for new models for making inference on picture or video. Another limitation on this platform, but it's a beta version which is very young. You can deploy only TensorFlow model on it. Other frameworks are not yet supported. Maybe in 2020, but for now, only TensorFlow is here. So the VM, either in generally available or in beta version, are very easy to deploy on GCP because you have only to run one command line to deploy it. Specify the version, the region where you want to deploy the model, the framework version, and the model location. Only this, and you deploy your VM with one command line. The VM is a package, the binary is installed, the model is downloaded and deployed on GCP infrastructure. That is very great, but there is only one problem here. You are sticky to GCP, and sometimes you will like to host your model elsewhere, on-premise, on AWS, on Azure, and you have to deploy yourself your model. You have not the easiness of this platform elsewhere. That's why you want something portable. Today, the state of the art to deploy a portable solution is to build a container. Container is an envelope that isolates the contents of the envelope to the outside world. I mean, if you have two containers with two versions of Python, for example, you have no conflicts between the two containers because the containers are strictly isolated. And in a container, you can put what you want. I mean, you can put any language. You are not limited to restriction. You have any library, any binaries that you can put in it. And you have a lot of base image on Linux and Windows if you want. And above all, it's an industry standard. It's open source. We talk a lot about Docker container because Docker has built a wonderful product to deploy and build easily container, but it's open. And you have a lot of open source libraries that you can use to build your container. However, the problem of container that we oppose the most of time, the flexibility and the customization of the container and the easiness and the simplicity, the velocity of serverless. Because with serverless, you only bring your code, some line of code, and you deploy it on the cloud provider platform, like Cloud Function or AWS Lambda. And all the packaging, all the binaries, the library download and so on are performed by the cloud provider. It's very easy to deploy, but you are sticky to the platform. And with container, you are more flexible, but you have more job to do. In April this year, Google has take the best of the two technology, serverless and container, and release a product named Cloud Run. Cloud Run helps you to deploy container in production in seconds. It's natively serverless, and you can deploy anywhere you want your container. Deploying container in seconds means when you have your container deployed in a registry, for example, in Google Cloud registry on GCP, you can deploy it on Cloud Run, and in seconds, you have an application that scales to zero. I mean, if you deploy in development or test environments, you pay nothing because you have no or low traffic. You have one URL, you have SSL certificate, you have redundancy, regional high availability, you have production ready environments in seconds. And you pay as you use. That means if you have one request that takes 1 second, you pay for the quantity of CPU and memory that you use during this request. In addition, when we compare Cloud Run to other function as a service FaaS platform, as Cloud Function or AWS Lambda, when you have three concurrent requests, for example, three instances are created and each request are processing are processed on each instances. That means you will pay three times the processing job. With Cloud Run and also with App Engine, but it's not the purpose here. With Cloud Run, you can process all these concurrent requests on the same instance. And by the way, you don't pay three times the processing time, but only one on the same instance because you pay only the processing time of the instance and not of the request. So now, why I speak about Cloud Run in open source conference? Because Cloud Run implements Knative API. Knative, it's an open source project initially made by Google and today in open source, which come in top of Kubernetes. Kubernetes, it's also an open source product, also made initially by Google and today in open source. And Kubernetes has in charge to manage a cluster of VM, its name Node in Kubernetes wording. And on this node, you can deploy containers, its name pods on Kubernetes container. And the master node of the cluster is in charge to keep the stability of the cluster. I mean, if a VM is down because there's an update or there is an outage on the VM, the master takes all the pods deployed on this VM and redeploy the pods on the LC and VM. That was for Kubernetes, and Knative can be installed on top of Kubernetes, and Knative allow you to deploy pods only if you have traffic on your service. I mean, if you have no traffic, you have no pod deployed on your cluster, and when you have traffic, there is a scalability, and Knative scale the number of pods according with the traffic. Thanks to the compatibility with Kubernetes and Knative, that means Cloud Run, if you have a container compliant with Cloud Run, you can deploy it on GCP and Cloud Run. You can also deploy it on any Kubernetes cluster deployed on-premise, on AWS, on Azure, with Knative installed on it. And of course, you can deploy it on GCP, on Google Kubernetes Engine, which is the managed version of Kubernetes on GCP. Just to summarize what is Cloudrun, when you create an instance with Cloudrun, you have one CPU and 2 GB of memory, like with a tiny VM on an AI platform, you scale to 0 and you pay as you use. And above all, you have a portable container that you can deploy everywhere you want. So that was for online prediction. Now for batch prediction. Here, as explained before, batch prediction was for making a prediction of a lot of data. For example, I'm working at Veolia, and every month we have to send billing to our customer. And for example, I would like to add a feature to this billing, and I would like to forecast the next billing for the next month. For this, I would like to have to request all my customers in my database. We have millions of customers. I have to request all the previous water consumption of each of these customers, and I would like to perform in one time, only once per month, the prediction for all these customers before sending the results to my printing partner. So for this, I will request my database. I will request all my customers and all my water consumption. I will extract the data and store the data in files. Then I will submit the files to my models for performing a batch job for the prediction. I will get the results in files, and then I would like to reload the files in my database for sending that to my printing partner. This process works on GCP. We can use several components on it. For example, the data warehouse on GCP is a BigQuery. It's a petabyte scale data warehouse and very efficient for processing a lot of amounts of data. You have cloud storage for storing the file, and finally, AI platform for performing the batch prediction. At cost perspective, BigQuery can be expensive because you have charge on the volume of data that you scan in your database. And if you have millions of customers with many months of water consumption of history, it can be expensive. But if you have many customers, I hope you have a lot of money from them. Cloud storage is not a concern. It's about 2 cents per gigabyte, and it's not a concern here. And AI platform, it's depend of the machine type and the duration of your process. Of course, if you have a lot of prediction to perform, it will take time, and it will be more expensive. That's a great process, but here there is one problem. It's not a real problem, but you have to extract the data, perform the a process outside, and then to load the data again in the database. That's why 2 years ago, Google has released a product named BigQuery ML that helps you to perform 2 things. The first one is to train your model, standard model proposed in BigQuery ML, to train the model with your data. I mean, you have to query your data to get the inputs and the labels. You submit this result to your model to train it. And then, after the model has been trained, it's saved in BigQuery. And then you have the second steps. You can request, you can make a prediction thanks to this request with a simple SQL query. For example, for taking back our prediction for the billing, you have to query. I forget to say something about BigQuery ML. It's great to have BigQuery ML because you can train your model in BigQuery ML, and you can make the prediction thanks to BigQuery ML. But there is a cool feature in BigQuery ML that you can train your model outside BigQuery. I mean, you have to perform a custom model with neural network and conventional, recurrent, or deep model. You can do this outside BigQuery with TensorFlow. You can train your model outside TensorFlow, and then with your trained model, you can load it into BigQuery. Then you can make a prediction on a model not trained in BigQuery ML, but trained outside BigQuery. And then, for leveraging this model, you have to simply request your data in your database. Here you can request all your customer and all your water consumption. Then you have to, if it works, not here, yeah. You have to submit this data to your model to getting a prediction. And then this result, you can store directly in your database thanks to an insert select in your database. Thanks to this SQL query, with only one query, you reproduce the batch prediction workflow, and you don't have to extract the data, to store them in the files, to submit a batch job prediction, and so on. All the workflow is performed in BigQuery. What's the cost of this? Exactly the same thing as before. Indeed, when I talk about the pricing of BigQuery, you are charged on the volume of data that you scan on BigQuery, and not on the process, on the processing that you perform on the data. That means if you have millions of customers with water consumption, you will request exactly the same thing if you perform a prediction into BigQuery or outside BigQuery with AI platform. So now, what to choose? For online prediction, we have you have two solutions here, Cladrun and AI platform, and I recommend you a Cladrun for sparse request, because when you have one request per hour or per day, you are charged for exactly the duration of the request. With AI platform, you are charged for at least 10 minutes, because when you spawn an instance, you are charged for 10 minutes. And for the same reason, for spiky traffic, when you have a lot of requests on the same time, you have to spawn a lot of instances in the same time, and for the same reason, it's better to use Cladrun. Finally, the portability. With Cladrun, you have a portable container. You can deploy it on Cladrun, on GCP, but elsewhere. That can be a good point for you if you need it. In opposition, thanks to the new machine type on the beta version and AI platform, you can host compute intensive and GPU compliant model. That's it's important for making inference on a picture or video. If you have a sustainable traffic, it's also important because it's also an advantage to use AI platform, because the price per hour of AI platform is about 20% cheaper than Cladrun, and if you have one or two instances up all the day long, it's better to use AI platform. Finally, AI platform, you have to deploy, you can deploy your model with only one command line. I mean, you have to only enter a command line on your terminal to deploy a model in production. With Cladrun, you have to package your container, you have to build a Docker file, you have to store your container and to deploy it. It's more complex for no IT teams like data scientists and so on. It's not impossible, but it's not easier as an AI platform. Finally, for batch prediction, you have also two components, BigQuery and AI platform. BigQuery is recommended for structured data and data reachable by BigQuery. Indeed, the prediction is performed by BigQuery engine, and the data has to be requested by BigQuery. BigQuery can request a lot of data sources. For example, you can request files stored in cloud storage, files stored in a CSV or JSON format. You don't have to load the files into BigQuery. You can directly request these files into cloud storage. You can also request the data stored in Cloud SQL. Cloud SQL is a managed service of on Google platform for MySQL and PostgreSQL database. And you can request directly the data into this database from BigQuery. Cloud SQL also offers to host Microsoft SQL Server, but today, because it's a beta version, today BigQuery can't request MySQL SQL version at the moment. Finally, the most interesting part of BigQuery, you don't have to perform any data engineering stuff. I mean, you don't have to extract the data, to store the data in files, to submit the data to a job, and so on. You can perform the prediction and store the results in your database with only one SQL query, and any data scientist can do this. In opposition, AI platform is the best way for performing compute-intensive and GPU-compliant model, I mean on structured and unstructured data. So today is not yet available on AI platform. The new machine type are only available for online prediction and not for batch prediction, but soon in 2020 it will be available for also batch prediction, and you could submit unstructured data like picture and video for making batch prediction on AI platform. A final word on AI platform, it's also you can use the TinyVM for hosting TensorFlow model, but also for non-TensorFlow model like Sanskrit and XGBoost in comparison of BigQuery, where you can only deploy TensorFlow model with BigQuery ML. So thank you for your attention. I hope you enjoy this. You can reach me if you want on Twitter and Medium. Don't hesitate to contact me if you have a question on this. I will be happy to answer you, especially on the serving and processing part. I'm not a data scientist. I'm not sure to have the right level of answer on the data pipeline. So thank you very much.